where I don't know what edition of Visiting Artist Lecture. It's the first one since the pandemic, so we're just gonna start the slate new. This is our first Visiting Artist Lecture, and I couldn't be happier to have Carrie here to talk about her work. I don't personally know Carrie, so I'm not gonna introduce her. I'm gonna have Diane Martonis do that, but I just wanted to thank you all for being here and coming to this talk. At the end, though, I will let you know there's gonna be time for questions and answers, so please, I think Carrie would appreciate if you had some things you wanted to find out more about, so don't be shy on that point. So, with no further anything from you, grab my key and get out of the way. Diane Martonis, everyone.
From Massachusetts, Hartford area. What is it like? What's the vegetable that grows there?
Asparagus capital.
Asparagus capital.
Of the world.
Of the world.
What?
Yeah. Who here knew that?
I did not.
She's got both her BFA and MFA in painting, so she's a trained painter. She also has her doctorate in education. And historically, she's done a lot of independent shows. But the past maybe 5 or 6, 7 years, she's delved into a lot of commission work, collaboration with writers, musicians, and a lot of the work she's gonna show us today is a result of those collaborations, which is really exciting. So, Carrie St. Laurent.
Yay.
I've never done a presentation like this before using, I'm using YouTube because I'm going to have you all listen to some things today. So this, I'm gonna be kind of pausing and playing this YouTube as my slideshow as well. This is just sort of like my world right here. It's actually just a screenshot of my Instagram because it's my dog and the woods that I'm surrounded by in New England. I live, yes, in the asparagus capital of the world, which is Hadley, Massachusetts. It's Western Massachusetts, which is why I do not have a Boston accent. Probably since about 2019, I started working in Alcohol Inc. and I started collaborating with some writers and musicians. And I found that I really loved the process and kind of continued with that. So today I would like to talk to you about what that process kind of looks like, working with somebody else and trying to kind of pull imagery from visuals from audio and written sources. So the first project I want to talk to you about is called Nudes. It was a collection of short stories by Elle Nash, and Elle approached me and said, would you be interested in working on something? Elle was really open about my interpretation of her work, so we didn't talk about specific goals. She kind of wanted to see what I pulled from her work. So I focused on the title short story in this collection called Nudes. And the overarching theme that I got that I wanted to work with was this sense of reclaiming the body and sort of being an empowered woman. And so from that, this I started working with thinking about reclaiming some imagery by problematic male artists who have not treated women very well. So I kind of wanted to appropriate and reclaim the poses, and I wanted to kind of work with this idea of veiling and unveiling. I knew that. I started off with thinking about translucent paper. This was an interpretation of like a more realistic figure drawing I did from this Picasso piece. That was kind of the starting point with this project. And then I really wanted to come up with a color palette. So I started thinking about colors that were sort of fleshy and bruisy because there's some inherent violence kind of going on with the work as well. And this is just kind of a process looking at some of these images, the source images. Gauguin was a bit of a pedophile. how do you say that politely? You don't. No, he was pretty terrible. So I was thinking about how to reclaim these poses, but also make sure that I was not drawing a 14-year-old girl's body as well, like he enjoyed doing. And this was sort of the starting point that I got with it. And then I started, this is the Chuck Close piece. I brought it into Photoshop and I was trying to think about the idea of veiling. And I wanted this transparent layer on top of this work. I liked what the alcohol ink was doing. I liked how it was distorting the figure in certain ways. There were things that I liked about this, but there are also some things I was not thrilled about, so I was kind of a little bit stuck. So this kind of shows a little bit of like how I brought it into a digital realm and then manipulated it. This is just some more drawing. I was like, well, maybe I'll go larger scale and see what happens here. So this was the source image of Picasso and a little bit of video of me making this work. So this is quite a bit larger. I moved forward with this and did a bunch of drafts. Now, the work that I'm going to show you later, I kind of poured out of me really quickly and easily. It's always wonderful when that happens. This one didn't, and in this video, I'm kind of talking about how I painted this background because I didn't like a white background, and I didn't really like the edges that I was getting. The craftsmanship and neatness was really a problem. I'm kind of like pointing that out here. I didn't like the texture of the paint. It just, something wasn't really happening for me here, and something was not right about the framing, and I couldn't really figure out what. So this is another source image, Diego Rivera, and like kind of my pile of sketches and drawings for this. And then I decided to explore working with a circular format instead. I really liked the idea that the circular format could sort of represent a peephole or porthole. It's like voyeurism. And I thought about how I could work with the alcohol ink in this smaller format and kind of capture some of the inherent qualities of the alcohol ink. Whereas the large scale, it got like really blotchy really quickly. I find that alcohol ink, I tend to prefer it smaller scale. So I basically drew out all of these images. Salvador, this is the Diego Rivera, and I drew them out on tracing paper so that I could kind of play with that and basically fit them over the alcohol ink by sort of shifting around, seeing where it was going to overlap on the ink. And so I basically made several of, see, this went too fast. So I made several of these ink pieces, and then I had the several of the sketches, and basically I took the sketches and overlaid them on the ink pieces and shifted them around to find the best pairing for each of them. But I was still left with the idea of, well, I wanted to play with that veiling idea of a translucent kind of colored shape on top. Since I was working with these circles, it's like I could scan them and do this digitally. That's possible for sure. But something about this made me really want to work with a tactile kind of finishing. So I ended up getting some tulle and played around with working with this tulle as an overlay. Also because I find that tulle, it's like used for ballet costumes and like a lot of, used for a lot of feminine coded clothing and costuming. So I also worked with this kind of feminine coded color palette as well, with again like fleshy, bruisey colors underneath. So then I was just figuring out how to overlap this tulle. I used foam core so that I could pull the tulle over the side and then put pins directly into the foam core so that it could adhere to. So this would be that process, just a lot of playing around, figuring out what those folds would look like, and then pinning them in. So that is the it was a direct reference to the concept behind the story. The author was really happy with these and enjoyed the fact that it was not illustrating her story by any stretch here. After that, I kind of dabbled in a few other literary response pieces. So another literary response piece that I did was Bonding for Maggie Siebert. Bonding was another collection of short stories. Maggie's work is pretty intense, it's pretty gory, it's pretty visceral, and so for this collection, I basically created these illustrations that I kind of decided to call When You Know illustrations, for lack of a better term. You wouldn't really be able to tell much about the stories by looking at the images, but if you had read the collection, I feel, hopefully, that you would be able to connect each story to an illustration pretty easily based on what the color palette is and the kind of ideas and visuals involved. So they're pretty abstract, but I think that they match up, in this case, pretty clearly with the actual content of the stories. So that one was Bonding. And then I moved forward. I ended up doing a book cover commission, which I have here. It's going to pop up. I have a copy here if anybody wants to see it in person. Also the back cover, which is not featured. And this was a commission where the YouTube slides. I mean, it works, it's fine. So in this case, the author had a pretty clear concept of what he wanted on the cover in terms of basic imagery, but I worked with the color palette and kind of made my own take on it. I would say it's a pretty direct illustration of what the book is sort of about. This is what was called an eco-kaiju horror story. So it's about the environmental collapse in a way. It's about kaiju, meaning monsters, and it's horror because, well, people die. it's a novella, which means that it's quite manageable, and it's also delightful. Like, I loved reading it. I was just overwhelmed by the imagery that I was getting in my mind. And I was so overwhelmed by the imagery that I actually started kind of continuing to work on more pieces. Not for this author, just because I wanted to keep going with this color palette, with this imagery. I just really love it. So maybe eventually I'll have more to show on this one, but other things have come up since. This book is pretty recent, so that was sort of a time lapse of some of the literary stuff. And now I'm going to talk about one that bridges the gap between my literary sources and my audio sources. So this project was started in fall of 2019 and released in early 2020, so an interesting time to be alive, that's for sure. Happy to be alive. This is a horror occult novel by B.R. Yeager, and it's called Negative Space. I came about this project in a sort of interesting way. I would say that this project is really the start of all of this. Again, we're going a little bit back in time. Because the story was written, and then this guy's good friend, musician, and said, I really love your story. I'd love to do an audio score to your story. I was and am friends with that friend, and he's like, I'm doing this cool project, I'm writing a score for this book, and I basically elbowed my way into this one. I was like, this sounds really cool, I want to be involved, how do I get involved? I'd love to do some art response work. It was not a commission, this was like, this is a cool project, please let me be involved. They're happy to have me involved. But this is basically the start of all this. This is how I met all these other people and got all of these other projects. And the reason why I'm showing it now in this presentation is because you're gonna see how the audio comes into play, and then we're gonna move into some audio clips. So first I read the novel. I read the novel in 2 sittings. I mean, I just could not put it down. It's sort of a bizarre story about, well, why am I gonna give it away? I'm not gonna tell you what it's about. It's got some supernatural type stuff going on. It's got some drug use in it that is sort of like a psychedelic invented sort of drug trip. I mean, it's got a lot of interesting stuff. So first step was to read the novel and then listen to the score. I immediately had a color palette in mind when I read the novel. Like, there was just no question in my mind which colors I was going to use. Usually for these types of projects, I'm mixing, as I did with nudes as well, I'm mixing custom color palettes. So some of the pigments that I use are out of the tube, but a lot of them are custom mixes. And I sent like a test of the color palette to the 2 other artists, and they were like, I can't even believe that, but I'm gonna say this, but I thought of these exact colors. So that felt like we were sort of kindred spirits. This work I came out of me very quickly. I had noise canceling headphones on. I had my palette in hand and I started making work. So what I'm gonna do is it's gonna play a few clips of some of the process, some of the work that came out. I really want you to be able to see and hear all together so that you can see how these things sort of merge into one. Thank you. prevented psychedelic drug use where in its natural form was like a grayish purple color, so that's where that came from. But when you take this drug, you see black threads coming out of everything. So there are black threads coming out of everything. also kind of, you know, reference to sort of blood and violence, and then the sort of mossy greenish color is sort of the swampy kind of color that represents the environment of the story. So that was the result of this collaboration. The cover was used for the album cover for my friend, and he said, hey, you know, this was really great. Maybe album covers are kind of a thing for you. And I said, no. Actually, I said, this is your thing. I actually really love it. So I did kind of get some word out and make more album covers. I'm gonna show you more of those projects coming up here. So the next project is by God's Teeth. And this is just a screen cap of the Bandcamp, but so that you have reference of what it is. This is the cover art. This was a really interesting project because it was something that was kind of an older project that was getting some new life. So the original drafts of these tracks were very like poppy and vibrant, but the way that they were getting reimagined had like a pretty sludgy overtone to them, and you can see how I was really thinking about that in the color palette, using fluorescent paints, which will unfortunately never capture properly on a screen, but you can get a sense of the vibrancy. And I really wanted something that was just a central focal point to kind of grab your attention. This is a pretty different vibe than the last stuff that we were just listening to, so let's listen to a few of those. This project. project, I did a lot of, like, I would paint and then I'd sand and then I'd paint again, a lot of different layers. So it was a lot of building and then taking away, which I thought represented the project pretty well. I was trying to mimic what the artist did while kind of rebuilding this project from old material. Also, this was an interesting project because the artist had considered releasing it anonymously and sort of putting it out there. Sort of, I don't know if anybody's heard of The Armed, but it was sort of this group would kind of put out stuff that you weren't really sure who was part of the band. They would have actors come in and interview as part. It was just like really confusing. And so he had considered doing that. So part of the concept was, Carrie, I want you to do this work, but I don't want it to look like all of your other work. So it was a fun experiment. It was like, you know, we considered both being anonymous for this project. So I was trying to make stuff that didn't directly reference everything else that I was doing at the time. But it's kind of funny because if you look back at my BFA work, like, it's just like reference up the wazoo here. I loved working with neon paints and like kind of building layers and working with, well, moving paint is definitely part of all of my work. I also worked with this chain link imagery because I was thinking about barriers a lot. But other than that, it was kept really simple. It was intentionally kept simple. It was really process driven. So that is a very different kind of process for me to try to remove myself from what I normally do. Also, you'll notice that there were four pieces in this collection. It was for an album cover. A lot of the work that I'm showing here, I did multiples, and that meant that I was able to give the artist an option of, like, hey, what's your favorite one? You can pick that for the album cover. I don't always work that way. There are several album covers that I've done where they either had a very clear vision of what they wanted, or I would give them options in the production stage. So I would maybe do a few color palettes and then let them choose the direction and then complete one finished piece. I'm just showing you collections because then you can see all the work together, and that's what's highlighted on campus here. But there are plenty of like kind of one-off album cover things that I've done as well. And let's see, the next one that we are going to talk about is The Dead of Winter. Okay, so this is my most recent work release. Actually, it was hung here on campus before anyone else saw it. So if you saw it in the hallways, you saw it before absolutely anyone else. The album has since been released, so I brought a copy of the vinyl for you to take a look. So it's out as of April 7th, so now it's out and people can see the work. This is a description of the work by someone else who's just writing a piece for the insert for the album. You can say that it's a sonic horror movie. So this started as a soundtrack, and you can see that it's sort of about, it's got horror, it's got sort of a trapped and isolated feeling to it. But basically when the artist gave me this project, he said, the basis of the story is a abandoned school for girls in the dead of winter, isolated, and somebody accidentally unleashes a demon. So, I, of course, first listened to the album, you know, the demo album several times, and I'm intentionally not showing you more yet, because I want you to actually kind of get the cinematic feel from it. I knew a couple things. It's going to be winter time, right? It's called The Dead of Winter. It's going to have a reference to something evil emerging. I did do a custom palette for this one. I did not want to go with really typical, just straight blues for the winter time. I knew it had to be cool and cold and uncomfortable, but also I wanted to add some warmth to it as well to give a stormy atmosphere. And I kind of mixed a blue-green color that has a bit of a glacial feel, which you'll see. I pulled clips from this, so I couldn't have you listen to the whole album, obviously. It takes a while, but I pulled clips from the tracks in consecutive order so that you can see how the narrative progresses. Also, I painted these in a narrative order. So once again, this was one commission. He said, I want to commission you for an album cover. And I was like, oh my God, I love it. I'm going to do a million of them. I could keep working on this if I had more time. I love this project so much. And so I got the color palette, I listened to it, and you'll also see that the starting point of this process was to create large scale pieces on Yupo paper, which is a slippery polypropylene surface, so it's not absorbent like regular paper. The alcohol ink sits on top. And I would create these large scale images and then literally just lay them out on my kitchen floor and find frames within those large pieces. Of course, it's an album cover, so I was set on square format. So I'd find squares that I liked. They ended up ranging from about 8x8 to about 12x12. But I'm gonna just play it and I want you to try to follow the story. I feel like the narrative quality really comes through on this one. Thank you. emerges. You can see it kind of lurking under the surface for most of it. You can also see that I kind of created a visual language. So it was like working with these tree lines to create a sense of scale and distance, and then establishing sort of these barbed shapes here and then these branch shapes here. I did some sketches early on of, I did some research on old demons, you know, like ancient demons of different cultures, and looked at some imagery and did some sketches, and then decided I didn't want this demon to really have a particular shape. I just wanted it to have a sort of vague abstract form that would remain consistent throughout the work. And the end result was the album. So this is the album. I'm going to we'll take questions and have a chat, but I'm going to leave these over on the table if you want to take a look at them. Also over here, I left some, we did a little promo for the news project, and I have a bunch of postcards. It's like all the artwork from that collection. So if you're interested, you can grab one of these and you get some free art, which is always good. We like free art. Okay. That is, yeah, that's the whole show. So let's take some questions.
All right, I'll start.
Go for it.
Tell me about your experience using alcohol for the first time, and how was that after the other media you had worked with?
Yeah, I love it. I have always worked with moving paint and really enjoyed that. My undergrad work had a lot of like a base of paint pours, and then I was using like latex and old house paint and whatever I could find at the time, because I was, you know, college. I still feel like that though. And then from there I was working on a watercolor with clay board, so I was working with like a lot of moving paint with that. And hair dryer, still like heating and cooling a lot to figure out how to manipulate this paint. But one thing that I found through that series was that when I was working with watercolor, is that the white of the paper was so luminous that everything kind of had a real softness to it, almost like a candy colored pastels. And if you know me, I'm not exactly a pastel kind of person. It suited me at the time because I was referencing a ton of map imagery, and pastels are so frequently used in mapping that I was like, this works, you know? But I got really sick of working with pastels, and I wanted to get something where I could get deeper, richer colors. And I found the alcohol ink. I feel like it's one of those mediums that people will look at something and say, oh, this is so cool, and you're like, yeah, the ink did that. I mean, I didn't. You learn how to manipulate it, and you learn how to move it, and you learn how to consider pigments that float and pigments that sink and attach to the paper. And there's definitely a technical side to it, but I would say the ink does beautiful things on its own. So if anybody, like, if you like the look of this, just try alcohol ink. It's gonna do cool stuff for you no matter what. It's just a really cool medium to use. Obviously, ventilation is a bit of a problem. You probably saw I'm using like pure rubbing alcohol on some of that stuff. So when I'm doing that, I'm trying to, you know, wear a mask and things like that. And then I'm using brushes or alcohol markers on top. But it's basically just a super fun medium. I would recommend it. Yes. Go ahead.
So when you're talking about layered imagery, for me, it's kind of a conceptual problem. So I'm wondering if you look at, when you're doing the layered imagery, are you looking at sort of a linear thought of multiple moments in time on one canvas, or are you looking at one moment in time that is possible?
That's a great question. I'm not sure. This work in particular or in general?
Just in general.
I would say it varies. This work in particular, I was kind of thinking of moments in time because I felt like it had such a clear cinematic narrative to the piece. So I was really trying to capture like a progression. And when you see the work all together, which it's hanging here, the prints are hanging here, you can kind of follow that transition of how, like the first panel, I felt like it was one of those storms that was really peaceful, but insidiously constant, you know, like the snowfall is just kind of pounding down and you're like, this feels really nice right now, but this is about to get hairy, that sort of feel. And then there were stormy skies kind of collecting, and then there was like the demon sort of imagery emerging from behind, and then it was emerging at the end. But in other work, I would say that narrative could be layered. It's not really representing a moment in time. Does that answer your question?
So you've got music to pretty much everything. Do you start with music or do you start with an image? Or do you just do it simultaneously?
When I am working specifically if it's a commission or an intentional project, then I am intentionally listening to the music and trying to pull colors, imagery. I have some types of synesthesia. I wouldn't say it's like a full synesthesia, but I definitely see colors when I hear things. So the colors will come to me. Other times, if I'm just making work aside from these projects, I might be listening to music and then realize that I was influenced by that music later, where like it's just kind of happening. But I would say anything that's like a direct project, I'm really like, before I start working, I'm sitting down and listening to the audio completely alone without any visuals. And then I'll be testing color palettes, mixing colors, and then I'll sit down and make the art. But when I make the art, I'll be listening to the music again. I cannot tell you how many times I've heard this album. I mean, I listened to it over and over and over as I was making these because I didn't want to influence the work with some other audio source. So it really depends on the project, but when I have a end goal or a commission, I'm definitely gonna like give the audio like a very solid listen first and let it.
I have a question about how, if you can explain sort of, you talked a little bit about, you know, how the inks work, about you sort of having compositional ideas. Could you talk a little bit more about how when you're creating a piece, you're sort of reacting to what's happening intuitively, rather than having sort of this strict plan, this precise idea of how you want things to turn out? And would you say you're a planner, but you work more intuitively, or like how would you describe that process?
I would say I plan a structure to center my work around. So like I said, the color palette, I had the idea of using the tree lines ahead of time. That didn't like just come to me. I had some sketches with like little trees in them. But as I said, I also had some like more, I wouldn't say real looking, but representational demon imagery that I was looking at. And it, after I completed the alcohol ink, that it just didn't fit. I didn't like I tried adding one, and it was sort of like this claw shaped of something, and I was like, nah, this is not working, I'm not liking this. I definitely let the imagery that happens, the chaos that happens with the alcohol ink, really define a lot of my compositional choices. So I'll have a color palette, I'll usually have some sense of like a collection of visuals that I'm thinking about, and then when I frame these and cut out different sections of the alcohol ink that work for me, flipping them upside down. And this one was like defined by the negative space. Like the negative space popped out, and I was like, well, that's just how it's going to be. I can probably pull up this one. So this one, I just loved how this looked like a giant snowdrift, and I liked the shapes that were kind of pulling in here. And this one started by adding in like these little branch shapes kind of in this area here. And then I went with it and I started adding them. I was like, oh, I like how that looks like this is gonna be behind this snowdrift. And you really get a sense of strange scale shifting here. where like, if you looked at this section, you might think that these are tree roots, but when you think about that's a tree, like, and how are these the roots, that's how that's kind of scale kind of emerged. And then some other things are just completely defined by the, this one is actually, the piece is called Death Rocket to the Sun. This is a more literal approach. I actually put a sun in it. I don't usually do that, but I just kind of wanted to. I liked the idea of like this demon shape stirring and sending a bunch of birds flying into the air. So I was a little bit literal in this corner. I also think that this one had an unintentional nod to Stranger Things because it's got like an upside down. I didn't do that on purpose, but it just emerged as a reflection and I was like, huh, what's that? The things that enter your subconscious, right?
How did you illustrate the branches, or are they also alcohol ink?
I mean, they're illustrated with alcohol ink, but it's not that, it's, my work tends to be like chaos and then meticulous detail on top, or integrated, so this was done with like little ink pens and little brushes. The scale of this one, the original is small, it's only about 10 by 10 inches, I think. And these layers sort of, kind of emerged. And I think that this here, that shape here came from ink. You saw me in this process working with like a so that's like a little squeezy, you know, air thing. So some of these shapes that emerged from that squeezy air thing, that's a technical term. That's where I was like, oh, I liked that, how that looked like barbed. So then that emerged and then it turned into the shape that became the barbed shapes coming out of here. Like I didn't have that in mind. It came from the little squeezy ear thing and then I was like, I like that, I'm gonna keep using that and turn that into my vocabulary for this piece.
Okay. So I know you said you mix your own palettes. Do you mix your own?
Not for alcohol ink, I haven't made my own inks. I've played around with making some inks out of natural materials. Like I did an ink out of hopeweed. I don't know if you have that around here, but it has like these magenta berries. They can be toxic, so I was careful. But I made like a magenta ink out of that. I haven't dabbled much. I would like to, it's just a matter of time. But I'm just using manufactured inks of a few different brands usually. Some of the brands are thinner and will spread a lot easier, and then some of the brands are thicker, so they're gonna drip in a different way. And then sometimes I'll mix with pure rubbing alcohol or like a medium to get them to the way I want them to. I mean, the way I think I want them to. They're gonna do their own thing anyways.
So do you mix alcohol with the ink, or is it coming as a single volume?
It's their little droppers, so they're alcohol-based inks as they are. And then I am mixing, I'll turn this volume down here. So that is like pure alcohol ink, and then you can see I dripped ink onto it, and then I splashed rubbing alcohol on, rubbing alcohol to get this effect.
And are all these on the ink paper?
Yes. Everything that you've seen except for the one piece are not obviously, but this is on UPO paper, this is on UPO paper, these, yeah, all everything else is UPO paper.
The figurative
ones are also on UPO paper, but then they have tool overlaid. And those hanging here are the originals. So I don't have the negative space prints or pieces sold. Yay, that's great. But so the originals are not here. And the bonding series sold, so those aren't here. But I had several of the nude series still so the originals are here. Plus, with the tool, I wanted to be able to show them. They don't really look different digitally.
Did someone get one of the Bonnet series ones as a tattoo?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, somebody got this one as a tattoo.
Do you have an Instagram?
I do. my Instagram, I will give it to you. It's at MasterCoda, K-O-D-A. It's my old dog. It's just a, but my YouTube and TikTok, which I'm too old for TikTok, everybody. I'm so old. I'm trying because it's obviously moving ink is fun to watch. Short form video works pretty well for this medium. But the only thing that does well on TikTok are viral audio clips, which means I have to use them. It's not my favorite, but I am on TikTok. TikTok and YouTube is just my first and last name. Here, I'll bring this up. TikTok and YouTube is just at Perry St. Laurent. And this is my website and my email if you want to reach out. And then my Instagram is at MasterCoda, MasterCoda. I'm also pretty active on Twitter, which is happens to be where most of my commissions come from. I have a pretty active Twitter with a lot of musicians and authors, and so that's kind of where things have mostly emerged from. And then I do some, like these here are just pieces that I did not commission. I just have image licensing available for some of my work. So that's like a lower, budget to license something that already exists versus having me commission something, make you a custom color palette, do the whole thing. If I have a piece that I think will be a cool album cover, I will create a mock-up. This one has sold, but the album is not released yet, and this one is still available. So that's like kind of another thing that I just dipped into that like this year, though.
How important do you think it is to have a particular style as a professional artist? Like, if you vary, like all yours, I can kind of see that there's a similar theme.
Some of that comes from demand. If someone likes what they've seen before, then they generally want to see, like, if they're commissioning me based on something that they've already seen and liked, they usually want something in that style. I'm not a big on self-marketing. I'm not big on the fact that you have to be cohesive with everything, but also I'm not a super famous artist either. So I think it's really important to do what you think is fun, and alcohol ink happens to be really fun, and I'm not getting sick of it yet. So I do see myself continuing with it, but I also want to explore other mediums again and other styles. So I would say I'm maybe not the right person to ask. I'm always just gonna say, if you wanna do multiple styles, do whatever the heck you want. Life is too short, make things that you enjoy making. Unless you're trying to build a career in an audience very, very specifically, and that's not me. I'm a professor first and foremost. So I teach drawing, painting, color theory at Western New England University. I'm an educator. This is just like what I do for fun, and I'm very picky about the commissions I take. Like, I say no to people because I just, if your project isn't the right fit, I'm not going to do it because I'm a selfish artist. So being a selfish artist, I think, is really fun. I really like doing that. So I highly recommend it. But if you want to, I think if you want to build a professional portfolio, if you want to be a graphic designer, if I wanted to be a professional album cover designer, I probably would be pretty cohesive with my style and continue with that.
I also know what you're saying too, though. You would get requests for commissions that were so far outside what you enjoyed in your style that you were like, no.
Yeah, I say no to stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I also say no to like dog portraits and family things. Like, there's a lot of stuff that I'm just like, no, it's just not what I do. I don't have enough time in the studio as it is, so it's really important for me to love what I'm doing. And I think think the bonus is that anyone who does work with me on a commission basis, they know that I'm 100% in on what they're doing. Like, I am going to spend, you know, in the case of this album cover, I mean, I'm going to spend way more time than you're paying me for because I love this project so much. And I ended up making, you know, 5 pieces. The artist got the original, the commissioned artist got the original of that. And I'm not selling prints of the cover art, but the additional 4 that I created, I'm selling originals and I'm selling prints of those. So I get to make up some of that income as like saying, well, you got your piece, you inspired these, but I'm going to make up for all of that time by, you know, having those sales. And they don't mind because they get their pick of their favorite piece for the album cover, which is pretty cool. So if that happens, I roll with it because I like creating little sets of work. I think it's really fun. But like I said, some commission pieces I'll end up with just one finished piece and then they'll get that final product. And I didn't show any of those here, but I think if you look at my website, you can see some. Yeah.
When you started, how do you decide how to charge for your art?
Not enough is my answer. I don't charge enough. That's the
like, what's your thinking behind the price?
The price is how much will they pay reasonably? Looking at comps like of other cover artists and kind of figuring out what other artists charge, and then how much experience do they have, and like kind of placing myself in there as like, I'm not, I have some experience doing it, I have a lot of experience making art, where do I sit in that range? And then like I said, these are our license fees. So my goal is, my commission fees are slowly climbing as I get more experience and have a bigger portfolio, but my goal is to keep these and my print sales, which are their archival prints. And I'm doing 1 print a month, and it's only available for the month, and then it goes away forever because I'm trying to, create that interest of being like, well, if I want it, then I have to get it now. But those are, my prints are usually smaller, like 8 by 8 inches. They're under $40 for a print. They're like on nice hot press matte paper. They're really beautiful, but I want to make sure that they're accessible because I think art should be accessible. I think accessible art is important, but I also think that originals, like how many hours, as an artist, you're never going to get paid, like, you don't want to do that math of like, how many hours did I spend on this and how much did I make per hour? Let's not do that math. It's never going to work in your favor, but if you have some print sales and other things to bolster it, that will help. And like I said, these licensing fees, I think I have it at like $90 or under $100 or something. And I want to keep it that way because it's like, if I already made a piece and you want to license the artwork, that's just going to be a flat fee and it's going to be accessible that way that, people can afford my work. And then it's going to climb on commissions and it's going to climb on originals, depending on, the level of experience that I have. But bottom line, all artists undercharge for their work because people don't pay, it's just a tough market. I don't know what else to say about that. I know I'm like keeping you past one of the stuff. Thank you so much for sharing. And if you want to take any art or look at the pieces over there, please take a look. Be in touch if you have any other questions.